Holy shit. Saw that on a t-shirt in San Francisco, and I've been using it ever since. Hey guys, I'm Alachia, and that's pretty much my reaction to Game of Thrones Season 8, Episode 3. Wow. Woo. It was very intense. It's kind of funny. A friend of mine was messaged me after he had seen it, and he has one of those like smartwatches that can track like your heart rate and everything. And he sent me an image of what his heart rate had looked like after he'd seen the episode, and I was like, accurate, fucking accurate. So I'm up 9 points on my Game of Thrones Deadpool. I think for some reason I had predicted all the deaths correctly, or most of the deaths correctly. I just didn't get the episodes correct. So if you don't know, I linked on Twitter my Game of Thrones Deadpool, where I predicted who was going to die, which episode, and a couple other things. Like, I predicted that it would be Arya who killed the Night King. 3 points right there. I predicted that Ghost would reappear in this season. And then I predicted that Melisandre, Theon, Bronn, Ed, Beric would all die. I did not predict Lyanna Mormont would die. I didn't know that she was a one-scene character until I watched that little after-credit thingy in the show where they talk about the episode. I had no idea she wasn't supposed to be there, but it was interesting to see that we grew to like her so much as a character, only to have her obliterated in this episode. Because in my last video, I talked about how I thought she should be ruling the North because she's just so in command. She's very charismatic. She knows how to rule a people. She knows how to inspire people. She seems to know what she's doing. And someone in my comments was like, "Yeah, I wouldn't put too much hope in anything with her, because you know how the show handles what they do to young children in the show." And I was like, "Oh, damn." And then I watched this episode and I was like, "Yeah. I guess she was never fated to go very far, which is a shame. It's like, if you have intelligence and you know what the fuck you're doing in this realm, in this world, as a character, you're not gonna last." So I was talking to my friend, and he was really flabbergasted by the end of this episode. He's like, "That's it? That's it? Seven seasons of this buildup of the Night King and Jon Snow, and it's over in one episode?" And I had to keep telling him, I was like, it's actually an elaboration on the show's part, the idea of the Night King, that they had to create this grand villain as they were running out of book material, sort of creating this foe that would propel a lot of the stories forward and give you greater hero sort of moments. And in the book, there is a mention of a great other, but I think it's only mentioned twice and in passing. It's not like this great thing where it's like, oh yeah, the great other and the Night King. There's no mention of the Night King. So it's interesting how the show has sort of played off of that and sort of has built it up. And granted, it was 1 hour and 35 minutes, but I did actually expect them to drag it out for at least another episode. I thought really this battle was going to be sort of an arc where the first episode would be the Battle of Winterfell, getting to the point of, where they think that they can handle it, and then they get overwhelmed, and then the second part, which would have been like episode four, would have been, a lot of the conclusions as to how, especially in the case of Arya, how she was able to get to the Night King, etc. And sort of, I don't know, I just thought they were going to stretch it out longer. So the fact that it was over in one episode was a little bit shocking to me. Not that I'm too sad, because it means I get three more episodes of Cersei as opposed to two. And but I can see how people were really upset with that. I don't think I was as upset, because again, I knew that the Night King was a construct of the show, so for me, it wasn't that much of a buildup. I'm more upset that winter never came. I thought for sure it was going to, and that the land would be covered and everyone would be barren, and all of the land would be barren, all the people would be starving, and that they would be reaching some very desperate times, especially in Winterfell. I really thought that a lot of Winterfell would be just hanging on by a thread at this point, but they all seem to be doing just fine despite all of this promise of winter. So I did learn a few things from this episode. Number one, I need a new fucking TV. My True Blacks are not there. They're not there. Actually, that's not true. But maybe this is the year I get a new TV. I don't have like the shittiest TV. It's a 4K 65-inch Samsung, but it's not QLED or OLED. Although now that, I looked into it may not have been entirely my TV's fault. It could have been the fact that I was streaming off the HBO, whatever, I have HBO Go, and I was streaming it, and apparently the way that banding works when you're streaming is that the True Blacks just don't come out right. So the people who actually pirated the show probably saw a better quality version than those of us who were streaming it off of HBO, which is hilarious because I was talking to some people and they're like, it was fine, it looked great. And then a friend of mine linked me a guy who actually uploaded onto YouTube some of the 4K clips of the night sequences, the battle sequences. And I'll link it down below if it's still even up. I'm sure HBO is probably trying to take all that stuff down. But it was very interesting to watch that compared to what I saw. And I was like, wow, yeah, that's like so much more shit I could have seen. But yeah, and then on top of the fact that it was so dark, and I think it's just maybe, HBO and the cinematographer did not think about the streaming aspect, right? They probably look at the dailies or when they're editing their film footage, they're looking at, top of the line screens, and it probably looked great on their end, but when you come down to like, and you stream it across the network, and depending on especially your internet connection, it can end up just looking like it was just blackness. I could see certain things moving. I can get the idea of what was going on. And I think that may have added to the intenseness, actually, because I couldn't tell what the fuck was happening. So I was like, oh shit, this is it. This is, Ghost is going in and he's gonna die. Oh, but wait, did he come out? I can't, was that him? And then the same thing would happen with, say, Podrick and Brienne and Jaime, where I think I was seeing them dying, but I couldn't quite tell. And I was freaking out because I was like, oh God, here it is, here it is, it's happening, it's happening. And as much as you predict that these things are going to happen, what you don't realize is you still have quite an emotional connection to these characters. So even though you prepare yourself, you're like, oh yeah, Brienne's so dead, Podrick's dead, they're all dead. You've kind of like watched these characters and they've been with you for 7, 8 years. So the finality of watching them die always kind of has an emotional resonance. And for some reason, I guess the way that they ended up editing it, they were just like, we got to hit that emotional resonance over and over and over again. But unfortunately, whoever edited it just kept repeating that same thing. So by the third time, I thought that Sam had been overwhelmed and I was not prepared to see him die yet. It just kept taking me up to that point where I was like, oh God, here it is. He's dead. Wasn't prepared. Grey Worm. Oh shit, Grey Worm. Oh, Missandei. Oh, I'm so sorry. It's happened. It's happening. And then the next scene, they show up alive. And I was like, wait, what? So that's kind of why like my heart rate was like going so much during this episode is because I kept thinking, everyone's fucked. One of the other things I learned is that apparently the Starks have no clue about tower defense. So that's when I was looking at the way that they'd set everything up, where they put all their infantry in front of the catapults and the trenches. The fact that they didn't have anyone manning the walls until it was too late. They were screaming, "Man the walls! Man the walls!" And I was just like, "What kind of fucking tower defense doesn't already have the walls manned with archers and everything. So I looked at the situation they were in and the way that it was presented in the episode, and I kept thinking, these people are so fucked. Everyone's gonna die. This is awesome. It's intense. It's so intense. And then you'd think that they'd come to that moment because, you know, they were just so stupid, you know, sending their infantry in to attack darkness. It's like, I know the Dothraki are offensive army. Okay, I know that. I know that they like to charge out into open battle, but normally I think they can see what they're actually charging into. Who charges into darkness? It reminded me of that clip where the DM is basically going like, why are you casting magic missile? You know, there's nothing to attack. And he's like, I attack the darkness.
Why are you casting magic missile? There's nothing to attack here. I'm attacking the darkness.
The Dothraki are like, we're going to attack the darkness. And it just seemed like such a waste, right? So, but I, again, hitting you with that emotional resonance over and over again. It's like, oh, there they go. The Dothraki's light snuffed out, you know, the light that Melisandre had given them. It was like, okay, well, that was totally worthless, pointless. I think her coming back, I really thought, was going to be the mark of her bringing on more prophecy. But in the end, they just needed to put her back in there so they could kill her and say, hey, we've done this thing with her. I don't think she really had that much of a point. I know that in the show, it kind of led you to believe that she was the reason that Arya Stark kind of had the last minute courage, ambition, or know-how, or I don't know, pep talk she needed in order to kill the Night King, but I thought that was very contrived and really silly. But speaking of Arya, the idea in this episode is that the pacing, I thought, really helped add to the tension. So for instance, you have the Dothraki charge, them being snuffed out. You have Dany and Jon abandoning their plan. You see the Unsullied basically being, you know, used as fodder. The chaos of the Bannermen not knowing what to fucking do and just being overwhelmed. But then you have a moment where you go into this insane sort of like horror chase scene with Arya, where everything gets really quiet. And although I thought that made for good TV, in continuity, it made no sense, right? Because you have hordes swarming and you have people trying to retreat, and yet she's in Winterfell by herself, you know, and it just turns into this very intense horror sequence where she's trying to escape and not be detected. The only thing I really loved about that, of course, is to showcase how far she's come in terms of her skill, how very agile she was, so much like a thief. And I really loved seeing that part. That was just great. And it gave Ser Beric a way to die in a very glorified scene where he is symbolized as sacrificing himself for the greater good in a very Jesus crucifix pose, if you notice that. But then being cornered, and then Melisandre just happened to be in the right place at the right time to give Arya the pep talk, I felt was really unnecessary. I thought that maybe she might add some sort of magical element to it, to bestow upon Arya something that she never had before, but just to give her a pep talk, I thought, well, that was very silly. The other thing, of course, we learned that we already actually knew but confirmed is that Bran is totally and utterly useless. I loved all the memes that came out of that where he's just like, I'm going to go now. And there were like all these memes that he's going off to watch Avengers Endgame and all this other stuff where he just, you know, he basically goes out and watches the battle and chills out, as opposed to like doing things like maybe advising people, I don't know what his purpose is other than to be the human version of the Library of Alexandria at this point, where it's just like, we can't let all this information die out, and that's it. Again, probably goes to the to the fact that the showrunners don't know what to do with him. So I guess that's the best that they could do, was offer him up as a sacrificial lamb and an impetus for the Night King to show himself. Although if it was that important to kill Bran, you think that the Night King would step up his game a little bit to kill Bran, as in just blow fire over the entire area, and or send his horde exactly to Bran to snuff him out. But instead it was created for good television, which is to create that cinematic moment so you can have that, again, emotional resonance when it turns out that Arya kills the Night King. Now, I actually rewatched that scene a couple times, especially on the YouTube version, because I could actually see it from that clip that I'll link down below. Again, I don't know if it's still going to be up, but I was like amazed at how much more you could see in the 4K ripped version than you could see in the streaming. But I thought when I first watched it that you see the one of the white generals, he looks to the left, you know, this is as Jon is screaming at the dragon. You see a glimpse of one of the generals and his hair goes whoof like that. And he looks to the right. And when I first watched it, I thought that was Arya. I thought she had, you know, borrowed a face or took a face. And that's how she snuck up so close to the Night King. And I was like, that is so good. That is so badass. But as I watched it over and over again, I realized that probably actually was not the intention. The intention was actually just to show that she's really, really fast. And she swooped past all of the generals to kill the Night King. And I, you know, after I realized that, I was like, ah, man, like I thought, because, you know, when I watched it, I was like, why didn't they show more of her going around and taking the face and sneaking up? And I just thought that really would have showcased how awesome she is, instead of just giving her that one glory moment, which I guess the showrunners thought was going to be this big surprise, but I don't know. I felt like I saw it coming from the moment that Bran gave her the Valyrian dagger that was used to try to assassinate him. I was like, oh, she's killing the Night King. That's why I predicted she would. So I wanted to see more of that. And again, I thought that that was her. I thought that was her as the general wearing his face, and that's how she snuck up. And I was like, that is so good. That is so awesome. And then when I rewatched it, I was like, oh, that's why everyone was so confused in, you know, in Twitter when I was watching. I was going, you know, I check out hashtag Dem Thrones after the show, because it is far more entertaining than the show itself. It's so good. It's hilarious. Everyone's memes are just so hilarious. But a lot of people were asking legitimately, how the hell did Arya sneak past all of those generals? And I was like, well, obviously she was as one of them. She, you know, she took one of their faces and that's how she got so close. But then it's like, no, she didn't. She just literally somehow sprinted and got close to him, which I now realize is far more confusing than what I had originally thought. So yeah. But I think I really did appreciate all of the tension building that the director had used, you know, the flow and the pacing and those moments to like really keep you very invested and worried about the characters and the chaos that was created, especially because it was done so well with the sound mixing and the sound score and the soundtrack. You know, I don't talk about sound mixing and scores a lot because it's really hard to do without actually, well, I find it hard to do without actually showcasing the music. So I generally end up never talking about it, but it's actually so, so important to your experience of a show, especially with scenes this intense, with battle sequences, and anything that, you know, is taking you forward through intense action. Sound mixing is so important, and they just did a phenomenal job. And I felt like the scoring, the Night King's theme, obviously, was just beautifully played, and it worked out so well. But man, like, it just gets to the point where you cannot handle how stupid everything ended up, you know, where you can sort of forgive the fact that maybe the handful of Bannermen left were just not that smart. That maybe, see, it just doesn't, no, it doesn't make sense. You know, Jon, Brienne, Jaime, they all have battle experience. There's no excuses to why They were so ill prepared at tower defense. It's like fucking tower defense 101, half this stuff. And it's as if they abandoned all of that to create these cinematic moments of intensity so that you feel the loss. But because of the actions and because of the how ill prepared they were and how poorly executed their defense was, it's hard to feel sorry for them. It's just like when someone jumps off a building and breaks their leg, and you're just thinking, well, I feel bad that you broke your leg, but you jumped off the fucking building. And that's kind of how I kept feeling about everyone in terms of, you know, the loss that they're experiencing with all of their troops and with all of the, you know, basically all the soldiers, the Unsullied, the Dothraki. What a loss, wasteful, pointless, and it was really hard to sort of feel sorry for everyone because they put themselves in a really ridiculous situation. Now, I will say there must have been something going on with the editing in the editing bay where the director probably put these moments in where he wasn't quite sure where, say, for instance, certain characters would get swarmed. And so maybe he put in a part where it looked like Brienne was dead. You know, she's going to be consumed by the undead, by all the whites. And it's as if the director had in his mind that he wanted this version of some of the main characters, in particular Podrick, Brienne, Jaime, Sam, to be swarmed or overwhelmed, where you think, like, that's it, they're going down. And, you know, it's a very intense and emotional moment where you think, oh gosh, you know, this is it, they're gonna die. But then they don't. And so I feel like maybe he had created several of these, and in the editing bay, they were supposed to pick which version was the best, but they ended up just throwing them all in. So you have this, you have all these sequences, and you're just like, man, all of them have some serious Glenn skills because they keep surviving swarms and swarms of hordes of undead. And you're just thinking, how? Like, how? I can't, because that does, I mean, like I said, that's one of the things that made watching this so intense for me, was that I just kept thinking, this is it. Fuck. This is it. And then the next minute I'm like, oh no, like Sam's still going, like, ah, gah, gah. I'm like, God, that fucking dude is still alive. Are you kidding me? How? But yeah, so it was an emotional, intense ride. Some of it disbelief. All of it was very intense. And it was hard to watch for many reasons. And yet it's just sort of like a train wreck where you want to see it, but you don't want to see it. And a lot of it was due to the fact that they were trying to get that kind of emotional response out of you of watching your favorite characters go out, or any characters that you've, you know, had spent time with go out, and having to sort of really sink into that loss. And then it turning out that it's didn't even happen. And then you're, you know, I just felt like I was very emotionally confused for a lot of the episode. It was very, very weird. And then, of course, with the finality of the Night King and all of the whites going out and the threat of the stuff beyond the wall just vanishing like that. And it was intense. It was good TV, but it wasn't a good story. So I am very excited, though, because now we get 3 episodes of My Girl Cersei. My best friend is just like, I don't even care about watching the rest of the show because I wanted this to be about, you know, leading up to this great battle and all the mystical parts and the magical parts. And now we just get Cersei. And I was like, what? I was like, that's so awesome that we get 3 episodes of her. Although he was saying that maybe we actually only get 2 episodes, and then the third and final episode of the series will be kind of a epilogue. That's possible. It is possible. But yeah, I don't know. They are teasing that episode 4 is not a filler and that it actually is going to be intense and great, but we'll see. I kind of suspect that it is going to be more filler. But it's possible that they will align you to feel a certain way about the direction of what, you know, how the battle is going to go, and then flip it on you. That's my hope. because I want the Lannisters to win, but I have a feeling it's not. I think it's just going to go exactly how you think it's going to go. I think the show at this point is 110% predictable, unfortunately, as much as I wish it would unfold a little bit differently, because I know people compare the books and the show a lot, and they're just two totally different animals at this point. But if you look at the beginning of the series that focus more on what the book material had to offer, you'll realize that this is about showcasing how nobody really wins in war, and that there's no true idea of who is a villain and who is a hero, and that good intentions can be done for, you know, good things can be done for bad reasons and vice versa. But now it's very much a show where it's like, this is a hero's journey, and there's a clear villain and there's a clear hero. And at that point, when you shift the focus like that, everything becomes predictable, because you, of course, know the hero is going to win and the villain's going to go down. That's generally how that always goes. All right, let me know what you guys thought about episode 3, if you agree with me about how intense it was, but for all the wrong reasons. And let me know what you guys think is going to be happening in episode 4. And if you want to check out my Deadpool to see how I'm doing episode to episode, I will link my Twitter post about it down below. All right, guys, thanks so much for watching. And if you'd like to watch more, you can click right here or right here to watch more now. Until next time, see you on the flip side.